Every day we think and speak in percentages. Home loans, school exams, whether you want a new flag or not. Now we haven't always been able to do that. In fact, because percentages only appeared about 700 years ago. And they're actually an outcome of decimal, which came to us in about 1000 AD. Prior to that, very few people could even multiply or divide. You try multiplying these two Roman numerals together without first converting them to decimal in your mind. You can't. Only an expert can. But Roman is based on 10. Now, I want you all to do something for me. Hold your hands out in front of you. Everyone in the crowd, come on, you're going to learn a lesson here like this, and stretch your fingers out like that. Now can you figure out why many numbering systems are based on 10? Good. What if we had 6 fingers on each hand? Actually, 12 is a good number base. It's divisible by 2, 3, 4, and 6. 10 is only divisible by 2 and 5, and it never does thirds precisely. So it might not be the best system base, but it got picked up early, and it was just waiting for an upgrade. Now, a lot of ancient cultures had meanings embedded in their numbers because they were highly involved with religion. So, for example, when you read in the Old Testament of the Bible of an army of 7,000 men, it might not mean that exact number. It's using the Hebrew number for 7, which is a holy number. And so it might be referring to an unknown quantity of men, but an army ordained by God. In China, they're like 9. It stands for Confucian Familial Piety. And in Angkor Wat, that mysterious lost city in the jungles in Cambodia, the Hindus built their temples with 5 steeples, which indicate the 5 elements of the Hindu cosmos. And again, at Angkor Wat, the Buddhists give us beautiful imagery of the number 4, which are the 4 noble truths of Buddha. And here he is, gazing benignly out to all 4 corners of the earth, almost like a moral compass. It wasn't always good news either. Again, in the Old Testament of the Bible, the Israelites were punished for conducting the first census. Simply for counting themselves, they got in trouble. They were much more serious about privacy issues than we are. And then we have unlucky number 13, and in China, lucky number 8. And perhaps these are all hangovers of a bygone era in which there was a certain power of numbers. And then the big change came. And ironically, there were 3 great religions involved in this in a grand cooperative effort that none of them were really aware of. But I'm calling it the greatest interfaith dialogue event ever. So, around about 1000 AD, free of copyright constraints or royalty fees, Christian Europe was given the Hindu-Arabic decimal system, and it revolutionized counting. The Hindus gave us a very important part. The Hindus gave us 0. And 0 is a fascinating philosophical concept. You see, it's the Hindus that tell us we are everything and we are nothing. And they've taken this concept of nothingness, or the spiritual void, and they've moved it over to be a number or a non-number. And it revolutionized counting by starting a new cycle every 10 digits using the same 10 symbols. 0 is the key to multiplying, dividing, and percentages. So, for example, calculating interest on money. As we just saw with the Roman numerals, that was pretty hard, so money lenders were hardly trusted. But with decimal, anyone could do it. You see, compared to Roman, decimal is 10 on steroids. And it opened up this huge bridge of understanding, this bridge of knowledge, to unlock the powers of the universe, and we started to journey across that bridge. Shopkeeping and mathematics became easier, and smart teenagers undoubtedly learnt it and went home to the family castle over Christmas to tell their dads they could figure out how much interest he was getting from the local moneylender. Or worse than that, whether the king was ripping them off with his taxation demands. I mean, England executed a king in 1649 because the British hated being taxed. Oh, and incidentally, they gave the responsibility to Parliament. Parliament, Does Parliament charge less tax than kings? You do not want to know. You could do other things with decimal too, like calculate the probability of an ace coming up in your card hand. And French gamblers employed that mathematical genius Pascal to figure that out in 1653. And poker players and bankers have developed financial formulas ever since. You see, compared to Roman, decimal loves formulas and equations. And statistics too, which began in 1662. Statistics looks back, probability looks forward. What age did people die at? What are the chances of you living to 80? That question could not be answered prior to decimal and statistics and percentages. And people began to lose faith in the power of religion invoking the hand of God and death or their house falling down in an earthquake. And they began to look to these numbers for answers, a society of numbers. And in 1867, Karl Marx, the great socialist writer, gave us the reasons and measures for the poverty of the lower class. You could figure the poor out via statistics, and it changed the way we viewed guilt. Think on this. Prior to statistics, guilt was personal and individual. So, for example, 11-year-old poverty-stricken Mary Wade in 1790 in London was convicted of stealing a dress and transported to Australia. She was guilty. Guilt was personal. And then Marx told us guilt was social, and we had the figures to demonstrate it. And that pendulum began to swing from personal to social guilt. And that is still with us today, that argument. Was Mary Wade culpable for that theft, or was it society because we had calculated crime along with poverty and illness? And it doesn't matter what your opinion is on that argument, none of it is possible without percentages, statistics, and decimal. Now, some say Marx was actually a snob. The great unwashed could only be known via statistics. They had 5.7 children each, and they died at the age of 44. And there were no nuances of individuality among them. So take their land and cows away and form them into Russian communes. Well, that's what Lenin did in the USSR. And Mao Zedong, that legendary leader of communist China, went a step further in calculating enemies of the people in his grand vision of a new society. You only needed to liquidate a certain percentage for morale to improve. And Mao wrote to Guangdong Province in 1951, congratulating them on exterminating 3,700 enemies of the people, but reminding them they needed to top up their quota with a further 3,000 to 4,000. There's another set of numbers we need to really make sense of statistics, and that is the list. We love comparing ourselves with others, and woe betide us to be found further down the list, because rule number one in lists is only compare upwards. So, for example, people used to say to me, you earn more money in Australia, you pay less tax in Australia. And sometimes I would ask, have you checked Kenya lately or Peru? And the most honest answer I got back was, oh, they don't count. We're worse snobs than Marx. You know, it's not that they're a different race or colour or religion, it's simply that they're lower on a list that we only compare upwards on. Or downwards if being near the top of the list is the wrong place to be. And let me give you an example of being near the top of the wrong list. New Zealand has a rather high prison population rate per capita in that golden club called the OECD. How do we know it's a problem? Only in comparison to others. On its own, it's just a rate, it's just a level. Let's drill into it. I once lived in an African nation that I won't name, and it had a much lower prison population rate per capita than we do. How come? Well, building expensive prisons is pretty tough in a poverty-stricken third world country. You might almost say that having fancy prisons just shows how wealthy the nation is. And in any case, a lot of the time in those village courts, a miscreant never saw the inside of a cell. They might be given the original anklet. I've seen one. It's a hefty chunk of tropical wood that you can't saw through, and it's chained between your feet. And you can stumble around outside, but you can't run. Is this cruel? Well, I don't know, but you won't be beaten up in that prison shower block. And neither will you become a jail statistic. In any case, what's the easiest way to reduce that embarrassing percentage? Repeal a few laws, decriminalise a few things. You could once be jailed for wearing a bikini on Bondi Beach. Where would Australia be if that was still in force? And finally, there's another list to consider which sheds some light on that. And this is the Global Corruption Index. And the Global Corruption Index ranks countries from most honest down to least honest. And yes, New Zealand is always in the top four most honest. Now, I love that African nation, but you'll know why I don't name it now, because it sits about halfway down that Global Corruption Index, which is surely a list telling us who not to believe. Business and numbers. I was once employed by IBM and it was 6 times bigger than its next nearest computer competitor. And my career took me to live in Singapore because I was purportedly good at something. And one day the planners asked me up to the top of IBM Singapore Towers to review their sales forecast for the coming year. One look at the figures and I knew they were wrong. How could this be? Well, New Zealand had about the same size population. If you multiply this and add this, you get this. And they looked at each other and thanked me, and I caught the lift 19 floors down again. A few days later, one of the planners came to see me, and he said they could see my rationale, and I was probably right, but they were so far through the planning process and the formula so difficult to unravel that they would submit the numbers they had anyway. Now, this was in the then world's largest computer company, a firm that made machines that multiplied numbers together. Now, I wonder how often in schools or government departments or real estate agents they're under pressure to produce numbers from outdated sources or unworkable formulas. Is this anything to do with the fact that huge business contracts blow their budgets within a few months? Or an earthquake in Christchurch shakes up the entire global insurance industry, which is a sector that loves statistics and probability? I want you to think of decimal as being a language of numbers. Now, other number languages have existed. The most enduring, measuring time itself. Napoleon tried to introduce a 10-hour day with 100 minutes per hour to France, but they soon reverted back. And other number languages are on the decline, although the Americans cling to miles, yards, and inches. But many nations, including ours, abandon those and they go metric, another form of decimal, and they don't go back. Now, it's interesting. The world is concerned about losing indigenous languages and it tries to revive them. But not when it comes to numbers. It's all one way, especially in that stronghold, the very bastion of decimal, which is money. As late as 1705, Russia, the first nation to do so, decimalised its currency. Today, all but 2 of the 196 nations on Earth have followed. It is either the decimalisation of money or the monetization of decimal, with all those financial formulas that even governments are forced to give way to. You can go to any shopping bazaar on the planet, and you might not understand Spanish or Swahili or Japanese, but write down your price offer in decimal and you will be understood. Decimal is the only universal language the whole world understands. Now, can we blame these 10 digits for the deaths of those enemies of the Chinese people? Of course not. Can we blame decimal for the enormous debt burden that Greece now staggers under in the EU? Of course not. Are we about to discard decimal for misleading us with lists and statistics? Of course not. But none of this could have happened without this numbering system. So let's return to Angkor Wat that mysterious lost city in the jungle, which is also an interfaith architectural dialogue. And we'll return there for a metaphor about the potential of decimal, or indeed any breakthrough which promises to unlock the universe but can put us in chains, that can generate great wealth but creates poverty, to introduce good with evil. For they did more in Angkor Wat than build Hindu temples and Buddhist moral compasses. They too built bridges, enticing us across to learn more about their civilization. And the metaphor is in the bridges. But most people miss it because they're hurrying across on the journey. And isn't that life? But if you're awake and your eyes are open, you'll see it. For silently standing in stone, on one side of the bridge is a line of angels, and on the other, a row of demons. Thank you.